There we go. I think, was that your job? Did I delegate that to you? Probably not.
You can delegate it now, so.
Okay, there he is. It is on. Role playing. Why do we do role playing? Let's ask a question here. Let's start off with a question. Why do we do role playing? What's Role Play Wednesday? Why do we do this?
Easy in real life.
It's easier than real life. Is that what you mean?
No, I mean easier in real life.
It's to reflect real life. It's to prepare us so that when we speak to people, we have. Don't you love it when you have the right answer for the somebody asks you something and you know that answer automatically, spontaneously?
That's good.
Don't you love that? Do you ever have memories where you say, gosh, something in the past, and you say, oh, why didn't I say this, or why didn't I do that or that? That's the reason we do role play. Just seriously, to practice. Practice makes us better. And my feeling is also to increase our confidence. Probably the hardest thing for to gain financial success is sales. And sales to me, a lot of people talk about automating sales and things like that. That's fine. But most of us are in capital sales or large dollar sales. And how much of the decision-making process by someone is subjective? Is because, gee, I like Joseph. I like Tim. Okay. I like Lyle. I like that person. I'm going to do business with them. Maybe they're not the closest. Maybe they're not the longest in business. Maybe they're not the cheapest, but I like and trust that person. How do we get there? Practice. Right. So who's got a role play? Tyree, you got to turn on that video. Unless you have a doctor's note or something like that. I'll let Lael off. She's the new kid, and I know she's tell she doesn't feel well. Role plays. You guys have a specific situation, a stall, an objection, an encounter, a question, something you'd like to role play out. Or
Expired listing.
expired listing. To who? Who are you calling or speaking?
It's my question. So if listing is expired, would you call to realtor, or would you skip it and skip trace and call owner?
I always rather call the owner. Why?
It's easy to talk and negotiate.
Yeah. I'd rather speak to the person than their attorney, their accountant, their realtor, their mother-in-law. I'd always rather speak directly to the decision maker. That is one of the psychological triggers, the authority figure, the person who makes the decision. I think I was talk. Good question, Joseph, by the way. I think I was talking on Monday about giving presentations to the wrong person. Okay. And I have done that so often. And after 15, 20, 45 minutes, the person says, well, this is great information, but you need to speak to my husband, my wife, my father, my lawyer. And it was all a waste. How many? I had a Monday where I had a couple situations. I had three situations. Do you ever think, see, do things come in threes for everybody? Do you guys see things come in threes? I had three situations that wasted my time on Monday morning. I won't tell you about them, but they wasted my time. Guess who I got mad at?
Yourself.
Myself, because I allowed it to happen. I could have blamed the other people in situations. But it was my fault. And I hate being manipulated or wasting time. So if we can speak directly to the decision maker. Now, does that mean you can't call the realtor? You can call the realtor. Maybe they can help you. Maybe they can give you information about the owner of the property before you call them. How important is it for the people you network with? You know, how important is that? So, Rick, so call me up. I'm the property, the listing just expired, Joseph. and I own a house nearby you in near Charlotte, South Carolina.
No, Charlotte is North Carolina.
I thought you, oh, Charlotte, it's right on the border. You're right. The airport, yes. Is North Carolina. Does the airport just touch on the border? Just
it's not far from us. It's like about half an hour.
Okay.
But we are in South Carolina.
I'm still learning the geography of
North
Carolina.
No, that's okay.
Carolina.
That's okay. It's too difficult. I
know you're very close. You're a half hour away from the airport, though, in,
yes,
in South Carolina. I'm getting there closer and better every time. So call me up. The listing just expired. Hello.
Oh, I'm calling you. Okay.
Yeah, hi.
What happened?
What do you mean what happened? By the way, I love that opening. Thank you. That is the most brilliant pattern interrupt ever. What happened? That was great. What happens when someone calls you up and says in a question two words? What happened? What do you think is going to happen to that person on the phone? What do you mean? What they're going to respond with a question, right?
Yeah, I believe it's going to be some attention.
Yes, you got their attention. Go ahead, do it again. I loved hearing it. Well, let me hear it again. It was brilliant.
Ring, ring.
Hello, this is Claude.
What happened, Claude?
Who is this?
This is Joseph. I'm calling. Do you have property for sale?
Well, I did. I did. What do you mean? What happened?
I saw it on MLS, and now it looks like vanished. So what happened? It's really beautiful property.
I had the world's worst realtor. This property should have sold a year ago. And I had it on for 6 months. I relisted it again with the same realtor. I moved a year ago to Austin, Texas.
Oh, so it's vacant.
It is vacant now. It's been sitting on the market for a year. Are you a realtor or one?
No,
of those
no, I'm not. I'm not a realtor. But let me ask you, Claude. So you are paying right now two mortgages?
What makes you say that?
Because you moved to Austin, this house is still on the market, so you don't have mortgage on this house.
Oh,
yes?
No, you know, I paid that off 10 years ago.
Oh, that's good, because my wife would kill me for that if I would pay two mortgages at the same time.
You know, you're off the role play. I've heard this before somewhere.
Yeah, from you.
I'm going to use some bad language here. It almost sounds scripted. My script.
Yeah. But you said that it should be like immediate response on the question. So it's what I remember. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So would you like to get an offer today for that house?
I'd love an offer. I'll be honest with you. I need to sell it. I am 1,800 miles away in Texas. I just want to sell. It's a great neighbor. Have you been by the house? Have you seen it?
Just on pictures. But I can imagine this is it's beautiful. Let me ask you,
hold that question. Time out. What was the most important thing I said before pertaining to the finance?
That you have no mortgage.
Yes. What went through everybody's mind when I said no mortgage?
Seller financing.
Seller finance. Brilliant. Right away. Boom. If I said it was worth $500,000 and I had only a $50,000 mortgage, same thing, right?
Yes.
Owner finance. I have a ton of equity in there. If we can get the owner to carry the equity and we negotiate maybe just giving him the $50,000 that he owes the bank, but he carries the rest, interest only, principal only, owner finance. How much leverage does that give us?
It's a lot of, yes, sir.
That's investing. That's investing. Or maybe even a rent to own. Okay. If it's a large mortgage or something like that, we can negotiate a rent to own or something like that. The thing is, getting in the conversation and negotiating with this person, That is the key. Back in the role play, sorry to interrupt, but that was, I wanted to make sure you picked up on that.
I was just planning to do it.
I'm sorry.
Owner financing. Yeah,
you know me, I can't hold it back. I can't.
When you hear that there is no mortgage, you cannot hold it.
I really wanted, to be honest, I just want to sell it. I was thinking of listing it with another agent, but how did you get my number?
You know, it's somewhere in my paper. I don't know. So it's somewhere in the paper. You know, I found your number and I found that it was on MLS. Let me ask you, Claude, how much are you asking, by the way, for the property?
It's the comps right now in that neighborhood are, we just had a recent sale about 45 days ago for $510,000. Same house, same square footage, same builder.
Okay, and so I assume you want about the same?
Yeah, absolutely. I have a little flexibility. I have a little flexibility if that's what you're asking me.
Okay, no, you know what? I'm not asking for that. I'm asking for full asking price, but I need terms. I would pay you monthly for your equity. You would not think about it, would you?
I don't know. I'm not sure if I understand what you mean. I'm not familiar with financial terms.
Okay. So let's say I'm going to pay you whatever amount we are going to discuss per month for, let's say, 5 years. And at the end of 5 years, I pay you off with full asking price $510,000.
Okay.
You would not consider it.
I might. Off the role play again. I just embarrassed myself. I just called myself stupid, basically. I don't understand financial terms, okay? Psychologically, how does that, what did I just give you? What did I just admit to you? You know, I don't understand these financial terms. I don't know what you mean. I'm saying I'm a dummy, right?
So to teach you?
So how do you fix me? How do you make me, this is what I was talking about, charismatic selling. How do you go to me and say, listen, I had to learn it too. We all have to start somewhere. A lot of people don't understand this. When you fix somebody who admits their ignorance or mm-hmm. their faults, should you just let it go or should you fix it?
Fix it.
This is really important here. You never know what you're going to learn in a role play. You know, these are the little micro moves. Okay, I don't know you. You're a stranger. I don't know anything about you. How do you get me to like you, trust you? You know, hey, you know, ask me that. You know, I don't know much about owner finance or any of that stuff. I'm a plumber. I don't do stuff like that, banking and finance stuff. I don't know anything about it.
Oh, you know, it's a lot of people do not understand it. And unfortunately, I do understand it. And I would like to help you to fix your knowledge, you know, that you would understand it. Because it's beautiful things for you, for me, for county, for your wife, and for everybody else.
Okay, that was better. I'll give you a B+ there.
Okay.
Could he have made that better? Somebody else jump in here for a second. Could he have made that better? Could you have personalized it, Joseph? Could you have said, you know, I have the same problem. When I first started out, I didn't know anything about banking and amortization and interest rates and all that. You know, I know exactly how you feel. This is what we call bonding.
Mm-hmm.
When you bond with somebody, what happens?
They like you. They're on the same page.
How powerful is this when you bond with a total stranger? I don't care if you're selling insurance, real estate, car, luxury cars. I have one guy who sells. I have one client. He's in Rhode Island. He sells Rolls Royces. He goes all over the world and buys Rolls Royces. Okay. And then he resells them. Is that a pretty unique business, huh? Okay. Maybe we'll do a role play on that. The thing about it is when you bond with somebody, is that Is that using a little charisma? It's psychology, really, and it's acting. But if you make me whole again. On that. So I'm sorry I'm beating you up on this, Joseph, but
I appreciate it. Yes, that's fine.
It's to me, it's one of those little midi micro moves that changes the whole dynamic of the conversation.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, let's go back one more time, another shot here. I'm a dummy. I don't know anything about this financing and all this stuff. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm just a plumber. My dad was a plumber. You know, I don't know what you mean by doing this creative finance jazz, man.
You know, Claude, I do understand you, because when I started in this business, it was same story. I had no idea what is mortgage, what is amortization, what is the difference between 20 years and 30 years, and what is the payment, what is the interest, no idea at all. Okay, but now I do know, and I can help you to get on the proper track and understand it.
Okay, much better. Much better. Round of applause there.
Okay.
Much better. These are the moves that million-dollar sales people make. You know, most people will never hear them. They'll just feel them. They won't think, gee, what is he doing? If you do it correctly, if you're obvious, if you're a little over the, if you're not a good actor and you're over the top, they'll pick up on it. Well, this guy's just blowing smoke. So you have to be a little subtle, a little stealth when you do it. You know, now I know exactly what you're talking about. I had the same problem. You know, boom. When you do that, you're bringing them closer into you and they're relaxing. What happens when the prospect relaxes and they don't, you know, when they have their guard up, when you call them up, what do you want? Who do you want? You know, and you can hear it in their voice, right? They're really defensive. What happens when you get them to relax? It's a lot easier.
Easier to talk, yeah.
It's much easier. It's much easier. I'm on that. Okay. Let's go.
But do I have to admit that now I know about it?
Now I know about it.
About these mortgages, creative financing.
You can. There's something I use a lot. It's a fancy word to a couple. It's called self-deprecating. It's when you make. Do you ever hear a comedian make fun of themselves?
Yeah.
I have always liked people who say, you know, I'm a human being. I make mistakes all the time. It's my fault. My bad. I'm sorry. I like people who use self-deprecation, where they're so honest, or when they make fun of themselves, okay? I mean, when I do something, I think the easier way to say it is, can you laugh at yourself when you do something dumb? How many people here have left their $1,100 iPhone in their jeans and didn't throw it in the washing machine besides me? Okay, I did it. I admit it. And God bless Apple Corporate. I called them up. I told the customer service person, and he started laughing. He says, no one ever admits that. You know, they sent me a brand new one. This was totally my fault. And I just made fun of myself. The guy laughed. We're all humans. We're all human beings. But sometimes we have trouble communicating with each other. I think we hear too much negativity or too much garbage on the, you know, all this media and everything, little personal opinion. I think we get too much negativity off all this social media and news and everything. You know, all the people I know in my circle and my neighbors, my friends, my family, none of them are out there burning things down or protesting or breaking the law or anything. They're just hardworking, decent people. All right. Can we say that? Does everybody agree generally like that? Okay. But if we hear all that negativity and everything. But the thing is, when we admit, hey, I made a mistake. This is what I did. We're making ourselves attractive to people. How important is it to get their attention and to make ourselves attractive? Right?
Yes.
Are we in a competitive world, Joseph?
Absolutely.
We're a very competitive world. I don't care what business you're in. Most business, very, very competitive. Other people selling same or similar products doing the same thing. A lot of you are in real estate. Okay. I know Lyell is in insurance. There's 10, everybody you talk to is either in insurance, finance, banking, or real estate. Okay. It, depending on your social circle. Okay. So the thing is, can we, how do we get people to like and trust us very quickly? You know, say, you know what? I made the same mistake. I have the same problem. You won't believe what I, oh gosh, I did this one deal. Oh my God. I didn't have it. The house inspected and I had to replace all the toilets and everything. Oh, you never had a problem like that, did you, sir? Boom. And now you're really engaging that person and you're bringing them in closer. You're bonding. Okay. Back in the role play. Close me, Joseph. You got on a 1 through 10. I'm probably, what number would you give me?
Maybe 6.
I was thinking, oh, really? Interesting. Tim, what did you think I was? Really? Okay. You guys are okay. I thought I was a 7 or an 8, but I think you guys probably, I'll take your opinion on that.
We'll give you a 7. Don't worry.
Maybe a 7. Okay. Because I said that I was frustrated with my real estate agent and I was 1,800 miles away. To me, that's a 7 or an 8, but you guys feel it was a 6. I'll go by that. Let's go back in the role play. Close me up front. You've now qualified me. You know the value of the house. You know the financing. On a 1 through 10, I'm a 6. How do you get me to an 8, 9, or 10 and get a commitment from me? We've moved from agenda to qualification, now to close. The 3 little steps that are in the gut system. You're doing great, by the way. Go ahead.
Thank you. This seller financing in our situation could be, let's say I'm be paying you $2,000 per month, every month for 5 years. At the end of 5 years, I'll pay you off the difference. Just imagine, you are completely out of this picture. You are not going to mow the grass, fix the toilet, anything. So you're going to be relaxing in your Austin and Texan and enjoy the weather and the river over there. How does it sound to you?
It sounds good, but can I ask a few questions? I'm not sure.
Of course.
Oh, okay. Are you buying this or are you renting from me? I'm confused.
No, I'm buying.
Oh, you're buying it. And how much?
It's what I told you. I'm going to give you full asking price, what you're asking me. Okay, 510. I'll be paying you $2,000 per month for the next 5 years. For 60 months. At the end of 5 years, I'll pay you off the difference.
Is that principal or interest or amortized?
It's actually principal.
Oh.
Interest, you have to understand, you have to pay taxes. Do you want it?
You're going to pay the taxes too?
No. I'm going to pay tax. I'm buying the house. I'm going to be the owner of the house. But I mean, if you would like to have an interest, it means you have to pay taxes on this interest. It's what you want? Well, if yes, so we can discuss it.
Well, how much are you going to put down?
How much do you want?
10%.
10%. Let's say it's okay. Yeah, I can put 10% down.
And please don't take this the wrong way. You have good credit and everything like that. I mean, I don't know you. You know, this is the first good phone call I've ever had on this house after a year. It's almost too good to be true. It's almost too good to be true.
Yeah,
I've heard that. Just to interrupt again, as I always do. I've heard this from people sometimes that with lease purchasing or any of the strategies I do, they say this, it's too good to be true. What does that tell you right away that you have to fix?
Trust. I don't know. Some like that.
Somebody else. When the prospect
sounds like scam for them.
Yeah, there's doubt. There might be a credibility issue. Okay, this sounds too good to be true. How do you fix it, Tim?
I don't know.
How about it?
They don't trust me.
You could be having this little honeymoon conversation like I've been having with Joseph. We've been having a nice conversation. He stroked me. He nurtured me. He fixed me when I was acting stuff. Then all of a sudden, out of nowhere, those little creeping doubts came in.
We could try to isolate that doubt and sympathize and understand and say, absolutely, absolutely, this can sound too good to be true. But what we found, this is actually a great solution. So let me walk you through to, how can I make you feel more comfortable that would make sense for us to move forward today? If I were able to, you know, put some things in place. We have a screening system that we use, a little company called TransUnion, that we do to sift and sort through bad actors, if you will. What can we do today to make you feel comfortable that we can do a deal today?
That was good. You're on the right track. You got to. Here's the problem, and I'm guilty of this too. Sometimes we get emotionally involved. We go too long. Who should be talking? Who do we need to get into this conversation more?
The seller.
The seller, the buyer, whoever we're to, the prospect. Okay. Sometimes you want to keep maybe your explanations or your presentations much shorter.
Yes, thank you.
You know, but stroke and nurture, you know, good. Go ahead. Somebody asked me this question. This sounds too good to be true.
I don't know, Claude. This sounds pretty good. I mean, almost too good to be true.
You know what, Mr. Hudson? Can I call you Kendrick, Mr. Hudson?
Please.
I'm
please.
Claude. You know what? If I got a phone call out of the blue like this, I would feel the exact same way as you right now. So good for you for bringing this up. Thank you, sir.
Perfect.
Boom. What did I just do in that moment? It's all about moments, isn't it?
Calming.
Isn't it all about moments? Right? What did I just do in that moment?
Made him feel calm and that he, you know.
Do you think your competition would use words like that?
It normalizes it, humanizes the call.
Yes. Do the amateur salesperson, when they're threatened, when the prospect brings up a stall, an objection or something, does the amateur prospect get defensive all of a sudden? Have you ever heard that? Well, what do you mean? We've been in business for 50 years. Their tonality changes. What happens when their volume, the speed of their words and their tonality, their enunciation, what happens? Even over the phone, can you hear a change in attitude over the phone when the words come out differently and faster and louder and everything? Can you pick up on that real fast? You better believe it. You better believe it. So your competition, they're not going to be prepared like we're doing here today. They're going to get defensive. So we go and turn it around and say, good for you. Great. I am so glad you brought that up. You know, I would feel the exact same way. Is that bonding? Once again, we talked a lot about bonding 10 minutes ago. Okay. Do we totally take the air out of the balloon? You know, when we say, I agree, you know, you're right. I would feel the exact same way.
It's totally matching their emotion too. It's like mirroring them.
Are we acknowledging their is that statement, by the way, outrageous, really? Is it reasonable or outrageous that they brought this up on your Joseph is here doing a deal on a $500,000 home in the first 5 minutes on with me and we've never spoken before? Is that reasonable for that prospect to bring up a statement like that?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
And you better anticipate it and you better know how to deal with it. This is $1 million selling we're talking about right now. This is great stuff. You never know what you're going to learn in Role Play Wednesday. You know, this is really good stuff. Because can you expect somebody to bring up these kinds of stuff? Wait, gee, how do I know here's the one. Here's a good one. How do I know I can trust you? I don't know you. You called me from you just called me out from a business card or so, from a mailer or something like that. I don't know you. How do I know this isn't a scam?
That's a great question. I don't blame you for asking, but have I given you a reason to really not trust me yet? I don't know.
Do you know? Sometimes I do this. You know, one of my favorite phrases is sales is dangerous. And some here, let me give you an example. Somebody go, how do I know I can trust you? Yours, go ahead, throw it at me. How do I know this isn't a scam? Somebody say that.
How do I know this is not a
It
scam?
is, sir. It's a say. I just all I do all day long is call up people and try to scam them. Absolutely. Most people will laugh, okay, because it's totally unexpected. Can you use humor to shock and awe people sometimes? You can use humor. Sometimes just say, you're right, sir. It is a scam. How did you pick up on it? Seriously. And then you go off the role play. Then you go and fix it. Seriously, Mr. Hudson, you know, this is what I do. My name's Claude. Well, you know, and good for you for bringing, then you go up and stroke and nurture. Good for you for bringing this up. And then you go and you turn it back on them. Make them do all the work. Great rule. I used to hear from my mentor, if you're feeling stress, if you're uncomfortable and you're feeling stressed out and all of us, and you know that feeling where if you swallowed a piece of charcoal, a diamond might come out next morning. Okay. Bad visual right now, right? The thing is, can you now fix it with them and turn it around? Say, you know what? Good for you, Mr. Hudson. What would you need from me so that so that you feel comfortable in doing business with me? And I agree with everything you said, and I was just making a joke before. I'm glad you brought that up. Would you like references? Would you like to would you like to check me online? We're a member of the Better Business Bureau, the Chamber of Commerce, the Lions Club. Would you like to talk to my wife and kids? What do you need from me in order
Two
for this
hours. I'll
to
put my
occur?
mother on the line. You could talk to my mom.
You want to talk to my, okay, there you go. I want to talk to my mom,
I
oh,
scam my mom.
you know, I just, it brings a tear to, how many people here can say, you want to talk to my mom? I wish my mom was still alive. I miss her every day and everything. My wife's mom, we just flew to North Carolina, just turned 96. And I'm so jealous of her because, and she's like my other mom, I'm like her other son. But how neat is it to have a mom, who's fully cognizant at 96? I think that's great.
Biggest cheerleader. Yeah,
Oh, isn't
sounds
that
cool.
great? Is your mom, Kendrick, is a personal question, is mom around?
My mom is still around.
What a
My
blessing.
it is, and I've had the unique blessing of being mothered very well growing up and being held accountable and had a good mom.
Yeah.
My dad's not around, so I could definitely relate with that. It'd be great to have him around
Oh
too.
yeah. Robin Williams. Who remembers Robin Williams, the
Oh yeah.
comedian? He used to say, "Oedipus Schmedipus, Mom, I love you." Oedipus, there's a, it, I think it's a Greek story. He liked his mom a little too much. Let me stop right there.
That's funny. Rest in peace. Well,
I'm gonna lose my family show rating here if we keep up. The thing is, now you fix it. Kendrick, what do you need from me in order? You've got a problem. I'd like to solve it. I agree with you. You don't know me and everything. Maybe we could go on Zoom and we could see each other face to face, but that's not enough. What would you like references? Would you like to speak to some of my clients who I've done business with, Mr. Wilkinson or Joseph and Helen, or or Mr. Bryant? Would that help a little, or would you like to check my credit or something? Would you like to see some of my tax returns? I just did them the other day. Really, I did, we just did. What would you need from me in order to make you feel comfortable doing a deal when?
today, no.
Hey, baby. It's always about today, isn't it? What happens if we leave it open-ended on commitment?
Doesn't happen.
Gone.
Casper, the ghost, the friendly ghost, but gone.
This is one of the mistakes I've made. I always love to talk about my, I used to negotiate with people, and you got that mindset, and everybody's happy. It's the honeymoon period, the magic moment. And then because we don't want to rock the boat, we leave the commitment and the timing open-ended. Okay.
Time kills all deals, right?
Yes. Yes. Mr. Wilkinson, you know what? This is great. I love this deal. You're the first guy to call me up and everything like that. Listen, can you get, I want to move ahead with this. Everything sounds good. I got to go right now and walk my five chihuahuas and talk to my mother-in-law. Get back to me in a couple, get back to me when you can. Okay. And let's move forward with this. I really got to go though. Okay. So bye-bye, sir.
I'm frozen. Someone
help him. Mr. Joseph, I got to go. I love this deal. 50,000 down, 2,000. It's great. I love this. I can't wait to tell my wife. Okay, this is exactly, and you sound like a great guy. Can you, I have to leave though right now. Okay, my library, the library called and my books are overdue. So listen, I'll talk to you later, okay?
Is it a polite way to say no?
No, I want to do the deal. I love the deal. I got to get to the library. Otherwise they're going to charge me 50 cents for every day the book was late. I don't know if they do that anymore.
What's the day that when's the time that I can call you back? Is this later this evening work okay?
Oh, sure. I'm available anytime. Just go ahead. Listen, I've really got to go. Okay. So you're great. I want to do the deal. Just get back to me when you can.
I understand that you goodbye.
Joseph, take another shot. Don't let me go. Set a time frame. Claude, this is what we got to do. If you want to move, set a time frame.
No, if you would like to call me later or whatever, it's fine. Before we hang up, let me ask you, can you do me a small favor? And I'll call you in, now it's like 12:40, I'll call you about 2 p.m. Is it good enough time to walk your 2 hours and these books?
Walk those damn 2 hours. What did Joseph just do so brilliantly?
He just redirected and controlled, kind of got a soft commitment out of him.
Yeah. What did he, what psychological trigger did he use? Right from Cialdini's book, Persuasion of Psychology, the big R, he used reciprocity. He used reciprocity. Could you do me a small favor? Just one little favor. Just before we go, could we set a time for 4:30? Okay, because you want to do this deal. I want to do this deal. You're busy. I'm busy. Let's set a hard time right now. Let's be men. Instead of hard time, make a commitment, or you can say no to me and it's over. You pick.
Would this be a good time to say, to add to that, say, I understand you need to watch Chihuahuas, and can you do me a big favor? I'm going to go ahead and send you over the agreement.
I like that. Let's hear it. Let's say, Kendrick, I really got to go, man.
I totally get it. Hey, I'm a dog lover too. I've got a couple I got to get outside, but before I let you go, one last favor. I'm going to go ahead and send you over the agreement, and let's tell you what, let's reconnect this evening. Let's say 6:30, 6:07. Is that okay? And then we can go over and pick up where we left off. Does that sound fair?
Whatever you, what time?
Does 6 or 8 work for you?
And I go to bed really early. I have dinner at 4:30 and go to bed at 6.
That's perfect. I can get back with you at 3:30 and we can wrap this up before dinner. How about that?
Okay. 3:30 it is.
Perfect. I'll call you back then at 3:30 and you should have the agreement, and looking forward to talking again.
Yeah.
Enjoy those puppies. I don't know.
Thing is,
He's gone.
The thing is, you set a specific time frame. How important is it to do this? I mean, you're talking $500,000 deal here. You know, Joseph's going to sell that property and make himself, get his 50,000 back and make another 35, 40, 50,000, right? What happens when we let things just dangle and out in the universe? We're in a competitive world. We talked about that. Can someone else snag this deal from us? Anybody here ever lost a deal?
Oh yeah. After we warmed them up a little bit and educated them a little bit, and someone comes around behind us and.
That's right. There's a lot of good there's mostly bad salespeople, but I've taught a lot of people over 30 years. And you know what? If you don't close them now, one of my students will. Because they know this rule. They know this rule. You get one chance to kiss the pretty girl at the door. Sorry for the ladies on the thing here. I'm a male chauvinist sometimes. The thing about it is sometimes you just got to go for it. Just go for it. Besides the reciprocity, can we use assertiveness to a degree?
I mean, can we do a kind of a takeaway a little bit and say, you know, hey,
that's scarcity. Yes.
Scarcity.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, look, I understand.
Scarcity.
Look, I understand that you've got to go. I'm pretty busy myself, and actually I've got quite a few other calls to make tonight. I'm really looking to move forward on a deal today. I'm not sure what's more important for you is to, I don't know, but more or less like, hey, you know, I don't know if I'm going to be able to, I don't know, setting it up where I have other people to talk to as well. I mean, if this is really important to you. You know, we can go ahead and get it done now. I don't know. I'm digressing.
Mr. Prospect. I have made a decision. I'm still waiting. I have never heard a salesperson tell me that they have made a decision on the close. If it's done the right way, how do you think the prospect's going to take that?
He's going to get scared.
It's a dangerous, I always say sales is dangerous, right? They could explode on you, or they could say, you know, I like the confidence of this person. You know what? You're right. Let's move ahead. Boom. Let's go ahead. Joseph, I'll tell you what, I've made a decision. I know you're busy and everything. I've made a decision. We're going to do this deal today. I want to speak with you this afternoon, 4:30 or 5:30, sir. You pick.
You made a decision for myself?
I made a decision for both of us. You have a problem. I have a solution. We negotiated in good faith. I'm going to give you the $510,000. I'm going to give you $2,000 a month. You said that's what you were looking for, and $50,000 in cash down. And it's okay to, God bless you, if you say no to me right now. Or
5:30.
5:30. So you're a gentleman, sir. Thank you. Are you familiar with Zoom, or do you have an iPhone, by the way?
No, I don't know what is Zoom.
Let's meet on Zoom.
And I don't have iPhone.
I'll send you a link. I'll send you the contracts beforehand. We can, you know, and you can ask me anything. And if we want to, and we'll make a decision at 5:30. To move ahead with this deal, or it's over. Is that fair? Can I ask that of you, please?
Yes, it is. Thank you very much.
I love doing business with you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Have a good.
Be assertive on that, and get that commitment of time at least.
Well, let me ask you, and you guys can be honest here. Was that too? Some people might feel that's too pushy. I don't. I'm comfortable with it. But do you think some people are going to, that's a little too assertive, too pushy or anything?
No, I think if I had things to do and I was still being pushed to go ahead and do the deal now, that to me would feel more pushy than just kind of saying, okay, I understand. Let's lock in a time, you know?
Do you think we're in a society where it's all about my feelings and everything? Don't you think we, you know, don't you, I got to watch my opinions in politics here. do you think when we're in a place where somebody wants somebody to show confidence, but to a degree, you can't go over the top and be a braggart, and you can't be a bully either. But is there a place for assertiveness, decision-making, and saying to somebody, listen, do we move forward or is it over? Make a decision.
Yeah.
It seemed like if they were really trying to say no, they they would probably be taking it as pushy, and it would push them to say no. But I think it's going to push them one way or the other. And then at that point, that's all we need right now in that conversation is we need a decision.
I agree. Do you think it comes to a point, would you rather have them say no in that first phone call or even the second follow-up? Would you rather have a commitment for them to say no or fire me is the expression I use? Rather than this sounds great, Claude, call me, Tim, call me in 2 weeks. I'm getting my tax return and maybe we can do something then.
I would prefer they said no.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Are you going to be such a nice guy? We're all nice people here. Okay. We're all good people and everything, but are we at a point where it just keeps going on and we follow up and we leave voicemails and we go on and on and on? Is there a place for dramatic assertiveness?
Of course.
I think so.
I think sometimes prospects need that nudge a little bit. They want to be closed in a weird way. They want to know that they're in good hands and their problem is solved and they're done and moving forward. They want to know that person has the rithrawl to do that.
Yeah. Ellie or Lyle just said on the chat box there, sometimes people are on the fence and need a little nudge to go to the right direction. Are we influenced by other people? I'm walking around. I'm walking around. You guys got to go to the Walmart. Everything you need to learn about life is in the Walmart. Just look at the people. Okay. You're laughing a little too hard at this, Tim. He knows where I'm going. I love the Walmart, and you go there. Everybody has, what did I see? I saw a lot of people with ripped jeans. That seems to be the big thing right now. Okay. Have you guys seen that where the knees are ripped out or this and everything like that? Okay. Nothing wrong with that. You want to, and everything. Why is everyone wearing ripped jeans right now? I mean, I saw a lot of people, young, old, all kinds of people wearing ripped jeans with rips in them right now. Why are they all doing that?
Influenced by someone or someone in culture. Influenced by people.
Yes.
By others.
Yes. There's, I'm trying to find this. I have a board. I have a giant white board here with all my notes and things that I'm always glancing at. And I'm trying to find the one thing here. Another word for social proof is similarity. Mm. Okay, that's the word. I wrote it on this morning and it slipped my mind. Similarity. Do we all want to, if we see everybody's wearing ripped jeans, do we want to be part of that group now? Gee, that's, and I was a kid once. I had long hair, bell bottoms. I'm really showing my age now. Okay, does anyone remember bell bottoms?
Oh.
They were really big in the 60s and 70s. Flares, bell bottoms, elephant bells. Thing about it is we all want to get along and go along and be part of the group. Don't we all want to be part of the herd? Right?
Yeah.
And everything like that. So can we, if we do something that's completely different from the herd, that has a certain amount of shock value sometimes, doesn't it? Is that good?
It definitely grabs attention.
Oh, yeah. What happens when you go against the herd? When you do something, I'm going into dangerous territory.
It's like a pattern interrupt, and it's like you kind of get out of that white noise.
It can be dangerous too, can't you? You know?
Oh yeah, it could be untroubled waters.
Oh
waters sometimes.
Yeah. Has anyone ever been at the dinner table and somebody said something that maybe everybody else didn't like?
It's usually Thanksgiving, something political.
The political. What do we always say? What's the best thing is to stay away from politics, religion, sex, and the latest diet.
Right.
Okay. If you stay away from those topics at the Thanksgiving dinner table, you're pretty safe, you know? Unless you start talking about, sports too. not much left to talk about, is there? So when we go assertiveness, back to that. So we go and we use tactful assertiveness. Mr. and Mrs. Prospect, I've made a decision. Joseph, I want to do this deal with you. Subject to our next meeting at 5:30 today, I'm going to send you the agreement. If you'd like to get it back to me before the meeting, that's fine. If you have questions, fine. Could you do me a small favor? Can we make a decision at 5:30 whether or not we're going to do this deal? Is that comfortable for you?
Yes, it is.
That's great. It's okay to say no to me. It's okay to fire me. Tell me to get lost. Okay. I want to do this deal, but I have so many other things. I don't have the time to follow up and leave voicemails and chase you for a couple of weeks. I just don't have that time.
Okay. We are set.
Thank you. This is setting stuff up. This is how you get to closing and getting more closings than your competition. Who go, oh, no, call me whenever you want. Oh, listen, I'll send that to you. Oh, we'll get together, Saturday or Sunday or something like that. That'll be fine. Boom. Never happens. Never. It never, ever happens. Who's responsible for setting all this stuff up? The prospect?
Us.
We have to do this. Okay. What if the prospect doesn't like all these moves I'm teaching you? Let's go negative here. Role play Wednesday. I'm feeling uncomfortable here. You're a little too pushy for me.
So let me write down what would you like me to put in the agreement so that it would be comfortable for you?
Well, it's not that. It's just your attitude. You know, I've been in business a long time, and you're telling me I got to talk to you at 5:30. I got to get you back the contract. I got to fire you and everything like that. I'm a little uncomfortable with all this.
I'm sorry, please.
No, go ahead. Go ahead, Ken.
I can understand that. We just met, I apologize if I've come off as being pushy. Really what it is I'm really busy and I work with a lot of other, I'm an executive landlord. I've got people that I can put in this house that pretty quickly that we can get moving forward. So if I come off as being pushy, it's just really that I'm really busy and I'm very, focused, and I know what I like, and I know who I like to work with, so that's it. And I'm sorry to making you feel that way, but and that's the only reason. It's just I'm just a little under the gun to make some things happen, and I really like this property. So, look, I'd love to see what we can do to make you feel more comfortable that you and I can do business together.
Okay, give him a round. That was excellent. That was really creative thinking. Apologize some, you know, I'm sorry I come off that way, you know, so my wife says I'm like that all the time too, so I, you know, thank you for bringing that up, but I'm really sorry about it. Now that's one move, the apology. You want to take it to the 10th power now and save the whole thing? Send them something. Hey, you sound like a Kendrick, you sound like a businessman. Are you in sales too or something like that?
Maintenance, actually.
Oh, maintenance. Oh, okay. Let me send you. I just got this. I have the world's greatest plunger. Let me send you one as a gift. I was thinking like a sales book or a bottle of wine. You never know where. I'll either get a laugh or you'll hang up on me, you know, or maybe you want the world's greatest plunger. Okay. But the thing is, if I say, you know what, let me make this up to you. You don't drink wine, do you?
Yeah. Oh, yes, I'm having some now, actually.
Oh, yeah, okay. Oh, yeah, good. You know, nothing like wine at 9:56 in the morning in Southern California. You know what? I've got it. Do you like red or white?
Red.
I love red wine, too. Oh, Claudia, what's that one wine I bought? Troublemaker. I found this. I had a speaking gig. True story. I'm in Coeur d'Alene, Idaho, and everything. And I just wanted to stay in my room. And there was a Costco down the street. So what do? I went down to Costco. I got that nice baguette. I got a, one of those $4.99 chickens. And I went to the wine department. I just wanted to be locked in my room. Rainy, cold. I didn't want to socialize because I did it all day long. And I got a bottle of wine called Troublemaker. And I said, God, there's a wine label. Can you tell a book by its cover?
Right.
You know, I loved it. And it was delicious wine. So back in the role play. So you know what, Mr. Hudson, I'm going to send you one of my favorite wines. It's called Troublemaker. Okay. It's a real wine, by the way, from California. It's delicious. I'm going to send you this bottle of wine. And as my gift and my apology to you. Is that okay? And I think I have your mail address here. Is that all right, sir?
That'd be great.
What off the role play? What happens when you apologize, like Kendrick did, and then you throw in a little something extra that doesn't cost you a lot of money, but might save a $500,000 deal, a $15 bottle of wine, right? What emotion am I trying to bring out in Kendrick right now?
Reciprocity again?
Reciprocity a little bit, but how about?
Calm him down.
A little guilt.
Guilt. I love guilt. I was raised on guilt. What did you say, Joseph?
Calm him down.
Calm him down. You're calming him down, getting likability. Also, maybe gratefulness.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Gee, wait a second. I jumped all over this guy. I was mad at him. Now he's apologized. Now he's sending me a bottle of wine. What do you think's going through this? We're emotional creatures, right? Can we fix things? Can we change them around sometimes?
Yeah.
Okay. Would it be worth sending a bottle of wine with an apology to save a $500,000 deal that you're going to make six figures on?
Right.
You better believe it. Are these good moves? Smart moves?
It is.
Do you think your competition's going to do stuff like this?
No, I don't think so.
No.
They're going to beat them over the head with a 60% discount. And
what your competition does is they're repetitious. They go back. Did you ever hear a salesperson and they keep doing the same presentation over and over? Okay. That doesn't change the dynamic and the emotions in the prospect and the environment. Lael said, how do I salvage that deal in insurance when it's on the phone and can't send him a gift? If he's been offended from being assertive, you basically say, you know what? I'm sorry you feel that way. Lael, I think it's Lael because I see Ellie's name there.
Yeah, it's
Slayer.
I'm sorry.
Oh, okay.
My voice is just.
So you know what? You say, you know what? Do you like to read, Lael? Do you like to read? I love reading. I read a couple books every week. My wife reads 4 or 5 books a week. Do you like to read?
Yep, I do.
What's your favorite? Do you like fiction, nonfiction?
Nonfiction.
Nonfiction. Okay. Who's one of your favorite writers?
I'm actually on a really good book now. It's called The Mentor Teaches the Gut Selling Method.
I got him. He's I love that guy. He's got some great books and a marvelous sense of humor. You know? Absolutely. Absolutely. I'll tell you what. I'm going to send you a gift card from Barnes & Noble or Amazon so you can get some more of his books. I'm going to you know what? I can do that online right now. And I just have to hit a button and you get yourself one of those books, or I'll arrange to have the book mailed to you just so as my way of saying I'm sorry.
All right. Sounds good.
Are we friends again?
I think we are.
You think or you know?
I know.
Thank you. Got to listen for those words. Why did she say I think? Last thing. What is that really telling us when they use those wishy-washy words, those ambiguous, I think, I might, I could, I can, I might. I'll give it the one I love. Someone once said to me, Lael, Claude, I'm going to give this my highest regard.
Oh, that's nice. That's a nice reject.
It's a nice reject. Why did that's a, you know what? We'll do that maybe on next Monday or next time we do Role Play Wednesday. I do it the first of every month. The first Wednesday. Was it, did we take away a few things here today?
Absolutely.
Was this the fastest 60 minutes ever?
Yeah, it flew by.
Yeah.
Your courses always fly by too quickly.
Well, I like my style is seriously to teach you guys, to share with you my experiences, both good and bad, and just to have a lot of fun while we're learning. How many of us have been to those lectures?
Yeah.
Okay. What happens when we start yawning and daydreaming and doodling? We don't absorb anything, do we?
You don't concentrate, yeah.
You don't concentrate. You don't absorb everything. So you don't focus. So, you know, the thing is, if my style is, if we can keep it fun while we're learning a few things. Let's go around the room. Tell me one thing you learned today, Joseph.
Actually, a lot of.
I put you on the spot. I'm sorry.
No, that's, I love it. How to promote conversation, how to calm down, how to bring them to our world, how to fix them if they don't know it, they don't know something. I have one question in the meantime. I'm sorry.
We're going to go in overtime here.
If you ask, do you like wine, like you ask Henry, and he would answer, no, I like cognac, what would you do?
Oh, you know what? My wife just got me my...
Go get it.
This is funny you said that, Joe. You know, I have a... I have a thing called heightened awareness. Did you ever talk about a subject or a person and somehow that subject or person or manifests itself, that person calls you or you read about him or something like that? Claudia just got me a bottle of cognac.
Mm-hmm.
For our 37th anniversary, and we're both only 36 years old. I don't know how that worked out, but...
Nobody knows. Yeah.
Miscalculation.
Thank you. Anyway, Trader Joe's, okay, here. And I don't know if you could see this.
Claude.
Yeah, Chatelier, yes. Claude Chatelier, yes.
This is the most magnificent... If you like cognac, this is the most magnificent cognac ever.
So did she choose it for the name or for the quality?
Yes.
Did she go emotion or did she go?
Yes.
She doesn't like. I don't drink that stuff, but he likes it, so that's why I got that one.
I bought it the first time, and I don't know how the bottle just disappeared. It went right and
evaporated.
I bought it because of the name. I said, well, first of all, it's cognac, and
yeah,
they can only say cognac if it comes from a certain region in France.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
They can only say, otherwise they have to call it brandy.
Okay.
On there. And I say, you know, and I've never had a bad cognac from France or Hennessy and all. And look what we're talking about now. And Claudia got this for me. You like cognac. Here we go, Joseph. I'm going to send you a gift. Go online now. And I'm going to send you a gift card for Trader Joe's. And I'd like you to go get your favorite bottle of brandy just to put us on the right footing again. Okay. Because I want you to feel good about doing business with me. And if I was a little over the top, I'm sorry. Maybe I'm drinking too much. Maybe I need to switch the decaf. Okay. Boom. Is there, if we're relaxed and in a good state of mind, I think we get too tensed up in these conversations because they're unknown. Sales is dangerous, right?
Yeah.
We don't know what they're going to say. We're not mind readers. But can we practice it like we're doing today? So even if they say, I don't drink wine and you're too pushy, but I do like cognac. What's your response going to be, Joseph?
So I'm going to send you a gift card for Trader Joe. I recently bought very beautiful cognac. And I sent you the name and gift card, and I would love you to enjoy it. And I hope we are friends again.
We're friends. You know what? You don't have to do that. I'm sorry. I got these five chihuahuas that need to go for a walk. And I want to do the. Call me later, and let's do this deal. Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
You fixed it. Can you go from agony to ecstasy in one move sometimes? Can you change the dynamic of the emotion, of the feelings, of the environment by using the right words, the right way, with the right psychology? This is a skill, is it? They're not teaching this in any of the seminars, are they?
Yeah,
but
that's right.
But how many of us have seen in the real life by the magic sentence, the magic question, acting in the right way and changing the whole dynamic. My mentor used to say, pardon me, turning chicken shit into chicken salad. Okay. Basically, Kendrick, give me one thing you learned today. Let me go, and then we'll go.
Just to try to really just kind of whatever their objection is, just try to isolate it and try to figure out a way to make it better. Yeah. And just be real, just be human with people and let them know that you're not just some bot, you know, reaching out, because we have so much noise today and so much automation. Just to be real, right?
I love what you just said. Just to be real, not to be a bot. Are we automating it too much and losing that personal connection with people in order to do, is it okay to have that personal connection to do business?
I think we need it. That's the edge.
I really think we've lost that. I really do. Tim, you go, and then Lael, if you feel up to it, you get the last word.
Okay.
I think for me, one of the biggest takeaways was when you put me on the spot and I froze, which was you were really in a rush to get off the phone and how to like just quickly turn the conversation back on and commit to a time to reconnect. I thought that, I'm not sure. Kendrick actually did a really good job on that.
Of you did a good job. I mean, we're here just to practice, have fun. And if we say, I'm guaranteeing you, everybody, if you do some business today, you're going to go, holy shit, Claude was just talking about that this morning. This just happened.
Right.
That's called heightened awareness. This happens all the time. Good for you. Lael, last word.
For me, I think, it's okay to be a little bit assertive. That's what I need to learn, just to be a little bit more assertive.
You're a mom. You got to be assertive. What do you got, 2-3 kids?
Two boys.
Boys are real calm and sedate all day long, right, little boys?
Oh, 100%.
Boys. Right? What happens if the inmates run the asylum?
The guard's dead.
Too late.
I think we are in a society where being assertive is seen as being too aggressive, but I think there's a place for positive assertiveness when the prospect feels it's in their best interest. And I think it'll make you stand out, make you unique to that product. They'll remember you. How important is it to create a memory?
Yeah. Letting them understand why you're assertive with them.
It's huge. And I do owe an apology to Mr. Perez. Brian, Perez, you're driving that big truck while you're listening here. And I don't want you to take your eyes off the road or anything. Do you want to unmute you? If you want to unmute yourself and say something, it's your floor. You have the floor.
No, I'm just listening, man, enjoying the topic. You know, everything's good. I'm just enjoying, just listening. Stroke nurture and empathy.
That's it. Say thank you to people, show gratefulness, and then ask for what you really want. You'll see magic happen. Did you want the last word?
Yes.
Oh, I guess she gets priority.
Darn right. You know who runs this show.
No, I know my seriously. Place in the universe.
I'm just in the house, right? No, I just wanted to wish everybody a good Pesach, happy Easter, and happy Ramadan.
That's right. Yes.
Happy Easter.
Thank you. Same to you.
Absolutely. Are we missing any?
I think we got them all.
Is that it? Okay, great. Everybody take care. A lot of fun.
Thank you. Thank you, Claude. Thank you, guys.
Joseph. Thank you. And Joseph, try this brandy.
I know it.
Oh, you do?
It's really good.
Thanks, guys.
Take care, everybody. Thank you.
All right.
Thank you. Thank you.